very, very meaningful scene of the resurrection, that Jesus came into our lives. He died for our sinfulness. He became a victim. A total act of love, total act of giving for each one of us. And he's given us that hope, you know, in his resurrection, that as we die with him, that we will also rise with him. And so it would be fitting this evening for everyone to kind of put themselves in that mood, in a very, very prayerful mood. You know, we're very grateful for the youth of the parish for putting on this presentation, because as I reflect upon it, it is not only a very wonderful thing for us, but we're getting the fruits of their prayerfulness and their presentation, but I also think it is wonderful for them. You know, we're trying, every one of you parents here this evening, are trying to pass on your values, your Christ-like values to your children. And what better way than by reliving and taking the roles these young people will carry this into their adult lives. And they will be telling their children someday how they played the different role in the passion and death of the Lord. You know, I grew up with the legacy of every Friday, either afternoon as a young child or evening as an adult, of going to the way of the cross. In this particular church at the Immaculate Conception, as you know, very difficult to have the way of the cross because the stations do not depict anything. But in the church which I grew up with in, the cathedral had magnificent ways of the cross, the stations. And therefore, it still sticks in my memory. Every Friday afternoon or evening, reliving the death of the Lord. And I can almost recite it by rote. But tonight is an even greater gift to us, because these young people are going to present it in the most beautiful and prayerful way. And so I'd ask you, maybe have an intention. Now, for why you are here on this Good Friday evening. Maybe there is suffering in your family. In fact, I got a call this evening that a young boy, T.J. McNamara, 2.5 years of age, died. And he's going to be buried next week. And I said to the family, to his father, I said, you know, your boy, no sin. He's loved by the Lord, but our prayer is for you and the rest of your family. Now, the hardships of going through it, isn't that part of all of our journey of one time or another? And so this evening, if you remember the family, remember people in your own family. As you leave the celebration this evening, or before you leave, you know, one young boy over here, as I came in, asked me, is there going to be a moment to be able to kiss the crucifix? And so after the celebration, we will put the cross, the crucifix, on the pillow, and any one of you who would like to be able to venerate the crucifix may do so. Also, we have offering baskets.
Sign of his weakness. He had power, but was no power at all were it not given from above. Judge not, and you shall not be judged. Yet I often judge others, sometimes needlessly and rashly. Is it ever for me to judge another man or his motives? Can I ever do so rightly? Perhaps sometimes I have to make a judgment. Then, Lord, let me do so with real justice and with mercy. Let my motive always be love, love of God and neighbor, and not of self. Help me always to judge others as I would have them judge me. Teach me to judge others as I would have you judge me.
The second station, Jesus takes up his cross. A cross is synonymous in our language with the burden, something heavy, unwieldy, or unwanted. Jesus carrying his cross has made the cross a symbol of victory. It has become the sign in which we conquer. We need not think of it as a burden. My yoke is sweet, my burden light. What is my cross? It is myself with all my failings, imperfections, eccentricities. It is my fears, the fear of facing up to my responsibilities, the fear of boredom of my daily routine, the fear of being found out, the fear of what other people think of me, the fear of loneliness, and the fear of failure. Take up your cross daily and come follow me.
Third station, Jesus falls the first time. It's incredible that Jesus Christ, God made man, should fall down. We have to remind ourselves that he was man, like us in all things except sin. He was born, was nursed like any other baby. He grew up and advanced in wisdom and knowledge and grace before God and man. He was subject to the same laws of nature as ourselves. He was a man, as physically weak as all men are. He knew his weakness. My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Do I know my weakness? Is it part of my trouble that I think I'm stronger than I really am? Am I too impatient in my passage towards God? Do I stumble through overconfidence? Help me to know my weakness, Lord, so that I can overcome the petty faults which keep me from you. My thoughtlessness towards others, my carelessness in prayer, my obstinacy in holding my own opinion, my impatience and irritability. Help me, Jesus, to learn by my mistakes and always to lean on you.
Jesus meets his blessed mother. Can we really imagine this? The summit of a mother's selflessness, the giving of her son. Even if she knew all that was involved, it was still a loss, an inexpressible anguish, a suffering with him in perfect harmony, a weight of sadness that there was so little she could do to help, a contentment that she could be with him and comfort him. Isn't this often a mother's and a father's sorrow? The loss for a time of their children. Isn't it too a child's sorrow to be cut off from his parents by misunderstanding, a desire for freedom from control, loneliness, a feeling of being unwanted? Young people have their own cross to carry to the top of their own Calvary. On the way, they need the affection, sympathy, security of their family, who perhaps, like Mary, can do so little to help. Help me, Mary, to take my cue from you, to bear, if need be, the sight of my children leaving, to be with them when I am needed, to hide from them my own sadness. Help me, Jesus, to be understanding with my parents and to let them help me.
Station. Simon of Cyrene helps Jesus to carry his cross. What sort of man was Simon? What did he do for a living? Why was he in Jerusalem? Why was he watching this sordid procession? He was probably a very ordinary person, like you or me, just in from the country for a day or two, eager to see the city sights, inquisitive for cheap entertainment. Then he was hauled out from the crowd and forced to take part in it all. How did he react? Surely, he was first of all angry and afraid. This is so often my reaction when I'm hurt in any way. Anger and fear. Angry that someone has doubted my word. Afraid that perhaps I'm not right after all. Angry because my little pedestal has been upset. Afraid that I won't be able to get back on it again. Angry with the foolishness of others who won't or don't hold the same view as me. Afraid that I may be made to look more foolish than them. Help me, Lord Jesus, to master my fear and anger, which so often stems from pride and self-love. Help me to be at peace with myself, following in your footsteps. Seventh station, Jesus falls a second time. In the garden, Jesus prayed, "My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will have it." On the cross, he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Did Jesus have difficulty on the way of the cross? We take for granted almost his perseverance, his trust in his Heavenly Father. This was genuine perseverance, genuine trust. There's nothing false in the humanity of Christ. My way of the cross is pretty easy by comparison. Yet I, too, need the trust and the grace of perseverance, and especially in the sacrament of penance. My sins are so routine, I have to confess the same ones again and again. Maybe I can take comfort in this. Perhaps I'm getting no worse. I must learn to persevere in my sorrow, to show, by my actions, that my sorrow is real. Never to let my conscience become calloused. Never to become oblivious to a fault, however slight it seems to be. Never to stop trying. I must learn to trust more completely in God, to have an unwearied hope that in the end, like Christ, I shall overcome. After all, God has promised me just that.
Thank you.
station. Jesus falls the third time. You can scarcely blame the onlookers if they fail to see this as a triumphal journey. The psalmist's description is accurate enough. I am a worm and not a man, a scorn of men and despised of the people. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are disjointed. My heart has become like wax, melting away within my breast. My throat is dried up like a desert. My tongue clings to my jaws. And in the dust of death, you have laid me. A description, in its way, of me. Weak of will, lax of conscience, dry of love. In such a state, I deserve to be despised. I need both goading and encouraging. You speak to me, Lord, when I pray. Encourage me to listen to you patiently. You speak to me, Lord, when I am reading or listening to a sermon. Encourage me to listen humbly, intelligently, without undue criticism. Unless I become as a little child, I shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Lord, push me to perfection.
Tenth station. Jesus is stripped of his clothes. No one could be more humiliated than this. Who thought he was in the form of God did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself. He became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. He did not prize his possessions, neither those due to him as God, nor those due to him as man. He had no home, was often hungry and thirsty, was born in poverty, and died in poverty. I like to pretend to myself that I am poor in spirit, but sometimes I find myself terribly concerned about trivialities. Can I afford a new stereo, a new outfit, a new car? Should I take on another job? Will I get a new raise next week, month, or year? I know well enough that I'm not a lily of the field and that I must toil and spin, but I wonder whether I am often over-concerned about taking care for tomorrow. Help me, Lord Jesus, to be genuinely poor in spirit, to find a proper balance between caution and recklessness, to deepen my understanding of providence.
The 11th station, Jesus is nailed to the cross. It is the sheer, unmitigated cruelty of it which disgusts us, first of all. It seems unbelievable that man, created in the image and likeness of God, should be able to sink to such depths. We call such acts barbaric, inhuman. Cruelty survives today on the grand scale. Concentration camps, the violence of modern crime, the savage cruelty of some towards their children. I am so scandalized by the viciousness of some that I scarcely notice the speck of inhumanity in myself. My sarcasm, my lack of charity towards those in need, my ignoring of those I don't want to like, my willingness to gossip and say something hurtful, my condescension towards those more ignorant than myself, my impatience with those younger or older than myself, pinpricks, which besides Christ's wounds are nothing. But these are my faults, for which I am answerable. Help me, Jesus, to heal the wounds caused by hate, and to show to all men the love you have shown to me. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
Station. Jesus dies on the cross. It was about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over the whole land, until the ninth hour, while the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying out with a loud voice, said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said this, he breathed his last. Without beauty, without majesty, we saw him. No looks to attract our eyes, a thing despised and rejected by men. A man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. And yet ours were the sufferings he bore, ours the sorrows he carried. Greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. I am the Lord your God, your Savior. You are precious in my eyes, and I love you. Fear not, for I am with you. You are my witnesses, my chosen people, the people whom I formed for myself. Turn to me and be saved, for I am God. Return to me, for I have redeemed you. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself. Unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit.
Thank you.
13th station. Jesus is taken down from the cross. Like us in all things except sin. The dead body of Jesus. It's hard to take this in, that Jesus really died, that his body became a lifeless thing, an empty shell. If we have seen death, we know how unreal a dead body looks. So obviously empty, incomplete, utterly different from what it was a few moments before. And yet, truly, this was the Son of God. I wouldn't be human if I weren't entirely unafraid of death. A saint may say, I desire to be dissolved and to be with Christ. But if I say this, the words are a little hollow. Yet in spite of my natural human fear, I have hope. Christ has been there before me. My only wish is that when God calls me, I shall be able to say, like Christ, it is finished. The work you have given me is done. Help me, Lord Jesus, to approach death unafraid, confident that I have tried to do your will.
Station. Jesus is placed in the tomb. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Almighty Father, continually interceding on our behalf. The grave is only a passing resting place for us as Christ. The life, death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ is the promise for us of eternal life. We are one body with Christ. We are no longer alone in our pursuit for God. We go with Christ. We go as other Christs. We share each other's blessings and burdens, forgetful of self, filled with the same hope, fired with the same faith, united in the same love for each other and for God. I pray that in my life I may mirror Christ, that I may truly die to sin, that I may make my daily round my daily prayer, that by my love I may lead others to Christ, that in my God-given vocation I may be all things to all men. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that through him, with him, and in him, all of us shall find life.
Thank you. soldiers breaking through, drag us all away. Just before the sunrise, heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle, a voice began to call. Hurried to the window, looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. There was no one there but Mary, so I went down to the river. John stood there beside me, and she told us where she'd been. She said they've moved him in the night, and none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away, and now his body isn't there. Guys, guilt
Everybody love Dave!
Hey, Bob! Hey, Bob! Bob! Bob, get him in here. We gotta get a good look at the camera. All right. All right. Ew, just lost my appetite.
Can I lick the lens?
Ew.
Peace.
I'm gonna get sweets I had down in Carolina. I'm gonna have my wine cooler bottle.